Episcopalian, and I thank God you are too. You have been in my prayers for many years. First, because I met your dear Katie, and Katie and I got to know one another, and then I got to know her dear husband, and I got to know many of you through, I think I've been to the diocese four times in the last 5 or 6 years, and I have followed your faithfulness, your tenacity, your persistence, your love of Jesus, and your love of one another, and your love of the Episcopal Church. So from the wider church, thank you for your faithfulness and your witness. This morning's gospel from Matthew is part of the Sermon on the Mount, and the words are addressed to the same audience as those who heard the Beatitudes, people who were called to follow Jesus in a life of witness and grace. His words are addressed to all those baptized into the life of Christ, and the words are not only though for those sitting on a hillside in a distant time, but to each one of us here this morning. You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. We're not told that we should be salt and light. We're not told that we must be, or even that we have salt or light. We are told we are the salt of the earth, and we are the light of the world. We've been made into salt and light by virtue of our baptism. We have been transformed, and we're still being transformed. And these two images are descriptive symbols of what it means to be followers of Jesus. Let's take salt first. When we want to express a person's solid worth and usefulness, we might say she's the salt of the earth. During the time of Jesus, salt had particular qualities that were well known and appreciated. Salt was connected with purity. No doubt the whiteness of salt made the connection easy. The Romans said that salt was the purest of all things because it came from the purest of all things, the sun and the sea. Now, if the word salt seems a little, if the word purity seems a little out of date, perhaps the word integrity works. If you are the salt of the earth, you're a person of integrity, remembering that the word integrity means whole and undivided. Salt was also the most common preservative used during the time of Jesus. It had a cleansing quality and kept food from going rotten. So a person who is the salt of the earth strives to preserve what is good and holy and works against what is corrupted. Probably the most obvious quality of salt is that it provides flavor, and if you just ask anybody who's been put on a low salt or no salt diet, zest, tastiness, flavor. Being a disciple of Jesus does not mean grim-faced determination. Robert Louis Stevenson once wrote in his diary, as if recording an extraordinary event, he said, "I've been to church today and I am not pressed." We are called to lives of joy, even in the midst of adversity, secure in the knowledge that we are beloved of God. Then there's light. You are, not have to be, should be, ought be, you are the light of the world. And like salt, light has interesting qualities that make it a great image for Christian discipleship. Light is something that's meant to be seen. As followers of Jesus, our faith is meant to be visible, not hidden. Houses in Palestine were very small and very dark, usually with only one circular window, no more than 18 inches across. So a lamp, imagine a gravy boat. That's what the lamp was like a gravy boat, filled with oil with a floating wick. Normally, the lamp was on a lampstand that it kind of looked like a rough piece of wood, plain down, smooth. And when people went out, they took the lamp off the lampstand and put it under an earthen bushel so it could burn without risk until they returned home. Jesus was saying, don't hide your light under that earthen bushel. Light also serves as a guide. It can make clear the way. Think of the blue lights on an airport runway. Light can also be a warning light of danger ahead. Our baptismal covenant calls us to respect the dignity of every human being and work for justice and peace. And I believe that part of that vocation is to serve as warning lights for anything that degrades or diminishes another. So, why does Jesus tell his followers, you are salt of the earth and the light of the world? I think actually the answer is pretty simple. It's so that his disciples can change and transform the world and themselves into the likeness of God. No easy task, but that's the call. Great preacher Fred Craddock tells the story of vacationing in the Smoky Mountains in Tennessee. And he and his wife found a lovely restaurant at a place called, I've actually been there, the Black Bear Inn. He writes that they were seated there looking out at the mountains when this elderly man, probably in his 80s with a shock of white hair, came over and spoke to them. The old man said, you're on vacation, he said, and Craddock said, we said yes, and the old man just kept right on talking. What do you do, he asked. Well, Craddock wrote, I was thinking that it was none of his business, but I blurted out that I was a minister, and the old man said, oh, a minister, great, I've got a story for you. Took out a chair, sat down, and Fred Craddock said, won't you have a seat? Apparently, this man did this almost every day, and he was the former governor of Tennessee. The governor said, I was born back here in these mountains, and when I was growing up, I attended Laurel Springs Baptist Church. My mother was not married. And as you might expect in those days, I was embarrassed about that. At school, during lunch, I would go and eat lunch by the river. And I would eat my lunch alone because the other children could be cruel. And when I went into town with my courageous mother, I would see the way people looked at me, trying to guess who my daddy was. The preacher fascinated me. He had a deep voice and a rough-hewn face, but at the same time, the governor said, he scared me. But I sure liked to hear him preach. But I didn't think I was welcome at church, so I would go just for the sermon. And as soon as the sermon was over, I would rush out. So nobody would say, what's a boy like you doing here in church? One day, though, the old man continued, I was trying to get out, but some people had already got in by the aisle, so I had to remain. I was waiting, getting in a cold sweat, when all of a sudden I felt a hand on my shoulder. I looked out of the corner of my eye, and I realized it was the face of the preacher, and I was was scared to death. The preacher looked at me. He didn't say a word. He just looked at me. And then he said, "Well, boy, you're a child of..." And he paused, and I knew he was going to try to guess not who my mother was, but who my father was. The preacher said, "You're a child of..." "Why, you're a child of God. I see a striking resemblance, boy." And then he swatted me on the bottom and said, "Go claim your inheritance." And then the old man said, "I was born on that day." So what does it mean to be salt and light? Of course it means to serve God's people. The vocation is quite simple and incredibly complicated at the same time. Our ministry as followers of Jesus is to help people touch the resurrection, which is exactly what that Baptist preacher did for that small boy so many years ago. The ministry is always to help people know themselves as loved, cherished, valued, and bathed in the light of Christ. The ministry is to help people be born anew with the knowledge that they are the beloved children of God created in His image. That's what it means for us to be salt and light. Let us pray. Gracious God, grant us a new dream to awaken our spirit, to revive our faith, to restore our wisdom. Set us to work, to value your gifts, to transform our communities, and live your resurrected life. We ask it in the name of God, in the name of the God of love, God of community,